But I do remember the very first time I stepped into the UK, I didn't have culture shock. I wasn't shocked. I was more angry than shocked. I had culture anger. Guys, welcome to my channel. My name is Laju. If you're new here, you're highly welcome. If you're a returning subscriber, thank you and welcome back. I share videos on lifestyle and career tips for health workers and immigrants moving and living in the UK. So today's video is long overdue. I should have made this video years ago because currently most of the things I'll be talking about today no longer shock me. They become like part of my day-to-day life. So they're not really culture shocks anymore. But at some point when I first got into the UK, they were major culture shocks for me. Before I moved to the UK some years back, I'd been to the UK a couple of times in the past. And I think that was when I had the real culture shock. Although living in the UK and visiting isn't the same, but I do remember the very first time I stepped into the UK, I didn't have culture shock. I wasn't shocked. I was more angry than shocked. I had culture anger. I think if you're coming from USA or one of these other, you know, European countries, you can have culture shock. But if you're coming from Nigeria to the UK, you shouldn't be shocked. You should be angry because that was what I felt. I felt angry that, you know, I came to a country where things worked. I came to a country where the lights did not blink. I wouldn't call that shock. I was angry. I was angry not at the UK, obviously. I was angry at Nigeria. I was angry at the leadership of Nigeria. I used to be very hopeful for Nigeria. I still am, but I was really angry, basically. And that was my very first experience coming to the UK. I had anger, like I had anger issues. I got back home and I was just angry. I was angry at everything. But yeah, that was just my first reaction coming to the UK as a visitor. However, living and working in the UK gave me a completely different experience. A normal day in the UK is like taking an IELTS exam, you know, the IELTS exam. You meet people in random places, public places, at work, and they're very open and, you know, they're willing to share and talk about themselves. And it's shocking because I'm thinking, I don't know you and you've told me everything about yourself. You meet people on buses and they're telling you everything about their lives, their children, their medical history, you know, their progress, everything. They're just willing to share. And I'm thinking, wow, where I come from, you don't share your information with people. You don't share your life with people. Like, you never know. You know, everybody's suspicious of this person. You can't just tell a random person that you're going for a surgery tomorrow. You can't just tell people facts about your life. I came to the UK when I was pregnant and my experience was completely shocking. People would ask me, oh, how long are you expecting a boy or a girl? When is she due? You know, they were asking personal details and I was reluctant because where I'm coming from, people did not even know I was pregnant. And here I am, I'm telling you, oh, we're expecting a girl, she's due here. You know, I was just like, oh my God, this is completely different. But people were very open. And it's funny because in the UK, people do mind their business a lot. Like, the lifestyle is also private because, like, if you're in your home, you're just in your home, nobody really knows what's going on. So I guess when people come out of the seclusion, they feel like, oh, you know, they just want to express themselves. So I guess it balances out, sort of, you know, people are private, but then they come out and they're open. Yeah, I guess, and it works. But I was completely shocked at that because where I'm from, you don't tell people anything. You just keep to yourself, even your family. Like, you don't even tell your parents some things, you know. You just have to be careful who you tell what. But yeah, tell anybody, nobody cares, you know. Third culture shock I had is this. You know how back home in Nigeria, there's a lot of importation of, or rather exportation from the UK, from US, from around the world to Nigeria. People are buying, you know, clothes from the UK, clothes from Primark, New Look, you know, all those designer clothes, basically. And I just, somewhere at the back of my mind, I just used to think that you'll be able to easily find like a tailor. I don't know why I'm saying this, but it's still a culture shock to me that if I imagine a particular style in my head, like, oh, something fanciful, something unique to me, I can't just go outside to find a tailor or a seamstress to make me the clothes. I have to go into shops to look for that clothes, like, except I want to make it myself. You know, everything is like do it yourself. So that does amaze me, you know, that I can't just find someone, tell them, oh, this is the picture I have in mind. Can you make it? You know how back in Nigeria, we make clothes like every weekend. You just buy the material. You tell the tailor, put it like this, do like this. And you make your own style. You know, you bring it to life. You can't get that easily in the UK. It's not impossible, but it's really rare. You're just going to look for what you want in a shop or something. My fourth culture shock is about religion. You know how back in the days, the missionaries in the UK, they brought religion to Nigeria. So somewhere at the back of my mind, I expected UK to have like religion as like, they do have religion as their foundation, or rather Christianity as their foundation. But UK people are not religious. Like on Sundays, people are going swimming, going to the park. People do other things. Like church is not on their mind. In Nigeria, on Sunday, the only thing you are thinking of is church. So yeah, that came as a culture shock. And also, even when you go to church, people are not wearing their Sunday best. You know how you reserve some clothes for Sundays? In the UK, even your pastor is just wearing a t-shirt and jeans. And not just any jeans, he's wearing ripped jeans. You know, sometimes I'm thinking, who is the pastor? Where's the pastor? And he's like, oh, that's the pastor. Oh, really? Really? Is that the pastor? So yeah, that came as a culture shock for me that people don't dress in their Sunday best. I don't know where that word even came from. But yeah, that's a culture shock for me. My fifth culture shock is the habit of drinking tea. You know, everybody knows the Brits, they like their tea, you know. I didn't really understand the degree to which they like their tea until summertime came and it was so hot, scorching sun, very hot. And I went out to a program and I was being offered tea. And in my mind, I was thinking, have you been outside? You know how hot it is outside. How can you offer me tea? I just want squash, you know, I just want to take something cold and chilled, ice cream, something to just cool down. So yeah, the Brits, they drink their tea anytime after lunch tea, after dinner tea. Like tea is like a normal way of life. So yeah, that's a culture shock for me, by the way. And I mentioned squash, which is juice. In Nigeria, we call it juice. But yeah, it's squash. They said, do you want squash? Is that like a game or something? I don't play squash. And they're like, no, you don't want squash? Oh, juice. Oh yeah, I want juice. So yeah, squash. My sixth culture shock is this, paying TV license. The fact that you have to pay to watch TV. I remember clearly the first time I saw a TV license bill in Nigeria. I'd never heard of it. I'd lived all my life, like over 20 something years, and I'd never seen a TV license bill until I married and they brought it to our house. And it was just like a joke, like, what's that TV and radio license? And we just had a good laugh and we never paid it because at that moment I remember people thinking, oh, this local government people, they are just hungry, they want to extort us again, you know, what's this, you know. And nobody even paid it any attention. So coming to the UK and getting the TV license bill and seeing that if you don't pay you can get fined for it, it was a shock. My husband and I were like, wow, we escaped this in Nigeria, but you can't escape it here. But now we're like, have you paid TV license? It's like on direct debit, you know, we don't joke with our TV license, we make sure you pay your TV license. So yeah, that came as a culture shock for me. My seventh culture shock was realizing how diverse and multicultural the UK is, you know. The real shock I had was when I realized that not all white people speak English, because some of them are from Europe and other parts of the world. It came as a culture shock because it has happened to me not once, like twice or three times, where I'll be out in the park or somewhere and my daughter is playing with another kid out in the park and I'm trying to make conversation with the parents, you know. It just feels normal to just, you know, make conversation. And they're just something off, they're not really talking, and you try to talk and then you realize you can't speak English. So yeah, that came as a culture shock to me because I expected, I mean, England, everybody should speak English, but no, not everybody speaks English in England. And there are lots of Asians in the UK too, like especially in the medical field. Like I used to think lots of Nigerians are moving to the UK, but really you can't compare to the amount of Asians that are already in the UK practicing one form of medicine or the other. My next culture shock was realizing that ATMs in the UK are called cash machines. Now this was another funny experience because I was taking a taxi and we were making conversation and I asked him, oh, where can I get an ATM to use? Is there any ATM around here? And he goes, well, sorry, what's that? And I'm like, ATM, ATM. And he was like, sorry, what? He was just confused. And I said, oh, I would like to withdraw some cash. And he says, oh, cash machine. And I'm thinking, oh, cash machine. Yeah, that makes sense. So yeah, in the UK, it's called cash machine, not ATM. What do you mean ATM? I can't remember again. But cash machine, please. The next culture shock I had coming to the UK was realizing that when the British people tell you there's food at a gathering, it's not necessarily food as in food. Like there's a sweet tooth culture in the UK. Like they like their sweets, their chocolates, their candies. Which makes sense now, because I do remember every time you travel or someone travels, people say, oh, please bring chocolates when you're coming. Did you bring chocolates for me? And I'm thinking, is the only chocolate they sell in the UK? Why is everybody always asking for chocolates? But chocolate is a major part of their culture, you know. Chocolates at Christmas, chocolate at Valentine, chocolate at Mother's Day, chocolate at Easter. Every opportunity to sell chocolates, like chocolates are everywhere. You can't, chocolate is like food. So maybe someone invites you for a gathering and they tell you, oh, there's going to be food. Guys, just make sure you eat well before you go, because if you go with the African mentality of food, you're going to be disappointed. So make sure you eat. If you're going for any occasion, just eat well, because what they call food is basically not food. It's just candy, biscuits, you know, junk basically, and tea. Tea will always be there. Tea is very important. So once they have tea and biscuits and chocolate, you know, food is ready. But guys, that's not food. My final culture shock is this: drinking tap water. I know so many Nigerians that still come to the UK find this like amazing. Like, what are you drinking tap water? Can I just have bottled water? And for the first year when we came to the UK, we were always buying bottled water all the time, buying bottled water, because I just couldn't drink the tap water. It had this funny taste. There's just this taste it had, like, and the water is pretty hard. So It also doesn't foam well, so it just felt like this water cannot be right. But guys, I will never forget this experience. We took a taxi the first year. I'm saying taxi a lot because this experience occurred in our first year in the UK before we finally settled down. And I do remember we had bought lots of bottled water. We had packed everything into the taxi. And the taxi driver goes, "Why are you wasting your money? I'm sure the UK tap water is better than where you're coming from." And I froze. I was like, So yeah, but it really got me thinking, and I was thinking, I didn't say anything, I just kept quiet, like, okay. But it really got me thinking, it really got us thinking, like, okay, the tap water can't be that bad because after all, they can't be trying to poison everybody in the whole country. Everybody, most people are drinking tap water anyway, so how bad can it be? So with time now, I don't even taste it anymore. Now tap water is like my life. I drink tap water every time, every day. Like I just drank tap water right now in my bottle. So yeah, tap water came as a culture shock, and it also brought along with it some insults. So yeah, those were the 10 culture shocks I had coming to the UK. Please feel free to share in the comment section what culture shock you had or shocks that you had coming to the UK. Which ones you've gotten used to? Which ones you're trying to adjust to? Just share in the comment section. Feel free to like this video and please subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching. Bye.